Hatter and Stoden presents Chess Queens, the true story of a chess champion and the greatest female players of all time. Written and read for you by Jennifer Shahade. To my father, Mike Shahade, for making me a chess player, my mother, Sally Solomon, for making me a writer, and in memory of my coach, Victor Frias, for making me a champion. And to Daniel and Fabian for making me happy. Introduction. Recently, I conducted a poll. I asked hundreds of aspiring chess girls what they liked about the game. Most of them gave multiple answers: winning, meeting friends, the intrinsic beauty of checkmate. Some had practical reasons, like scholarships. But one 12-year-old girl's response stuck out the most: love to whip obnoxious boys. Beth Harmon, the hero of the book and TV series, The Queen's Gambit, embodied that ruthless spirit. In her seafoam silk dress with a withering stare, Beth seduced hundreds of millions of viewers into the power of the Sicilian defense and the joy of smothered mate. Grandmaster Harmon showed how dangerous it is to underestimate a woman's mind, because she will checkmate those obnoxious boys. The chess in The Queen's Gambit was more accurate than anything I've ever seen on screen. From the intensity of a chess stare down to the globe-trotting glamour of a top grandmaster on tour. The popularity of the show caused a worldwide shortage of chess sets and inspired new devotees from all over the world, of every age and gender. Chess champion streamers like Anna Rudolph, Qiu Zhao, and the Botez sisters saw their viewerships multiply in the frenzy, leading to sponsorship deals and a richer era for chess. Content creators studied Beth Harmon's games for each nuance and tactic, from opening finesses to endgame artistry. But the TV show was fiction. Chess Queens is the true story of the women and girls who broke down barriers to become chess champions. They resisted federations that barred them from playing against men. They protested the skewed prize funds that offered female chess players 10 times less than men. They shot back at organizers who asked if they were rated 25-50 for women. They conquered minds on the board and changed minds off of it. Chess Queens is also my story. I spent my teens and early 20s traveling the world, battling on the chessboard while coming of age. I celebrated my 16th birthday between chess games in Iceland and chased the international master title while crashing at hostels in Hungary. I explored Turkish baths and nightclubs at my first chess Olympiad and played a world championship at the Kremlin in Moscow. Connecting with people of all different backgrounds, ages, and genders over the chessboard reminded me that while a few games of chess could tell us which player was better, in life, nobody was better than me and nobody was worse than me. As the Italian proverb goes, at the end of the game, the king and the pawn go into the same box. I totally lose myself when engrossed in a chess position. As a teen and young adult, this was precious. Wrapped up in a middle game, I didn't care about what a guy thought about me, how popular I was, or if I was going to ace or fail a test. Those pure flow experiences taught me that true happiness was not just about avoiding pain and seeking pleasure, but also about deliberate focus. It wasn't all joy, friendships, and checkmates. I encountered sexism and old-fashioned attitudes and came up hard against some of my own weaknesses in the game itself, which ranged from a lack of confidence to impatience. The chessboard became a mirror for my mind, and I had to learn to like what I saw, even when it wasn't perfect. Chess Queens has a precursor, Chess Bitch. I wrote that earlier version of the book in 2005, just after I'd won my second U.S. Women's Chess Championship. On a bus in Atlantic City, I told my dad that the racy title of my first book aggravated some chess fans. It was even censored on many platforms, including the New York Times. My dad thought for a minute and then said I should rename it Checkmate, Asshole. Chess Bitch was a fitting title at the time. I wrote about things in the chess world that were unfair and sexist, but that I sometimes felt too agreeable to shout out. The title was my call to action, a reminder to tap into my own rage. And that flame lives on. Chess Queens honors a growing number of female champions all over the world while maintaining the fiery spirit of the first edition. This is an important time for all chess queens. While women have more power in chess than we've ever had before, we are still vastly outnumbered. And we're also outnumbered in many other arenas, from politics to coding to the boardroom. I believe that chess is a gateway for women into other fields where we're underrepresented. When I started playing poker seriously, I was often the only female at the table. I preferred to see other women, but I also knew that I could handle being the only one. Chess, like poker, is all about making decisions over and over again, even when uncertain, even when pressed for time. I believe in the power of women and gender minorities to make those choices on and off the board, and the importance of cultivating and celebrating those decisions. Resistance to female aggression in chess dates back to the 15th century, when the queen turned from the weakest piece on the board, only able to move one square diagonally, to the strongest, sweeping the board in one stroke. That game was at first referred to as the Mad Woman's Chess Game, mocking the powerful queen as crazy. Once the game was widely adopted, the mad and the woman were dropped, and now it's just chess. The potent queen changed the game for the better, but her credit was quickly removed. There is still plenty to be mad about in chess, from the relentless sexualization of female players to discourse erasing trans and non-binary identities. Shallow questions about women's supposed inferiority persist, while systemic issues like childcare racism and safety are minimized. Bitch may have been dropped from the title, but the chess queen was mad centuries ago, and she's still mad today. The book has changed in far more than title. It has been significantly reshaped with updates on each chapter. Opinions are revised by new evidence and experiences, and players are added to the roster of impressive queens. You'll learn about the Holocaust survivor, Isabel Shoko, who was rescued from the concentration camp Bergen-Belsen when she weighed just 55 pounds. She made a full recovery and later became the French women's champion. Ludmila Rodenko, the second women's world champion, will inspire you with her wins, but even more with her heroism in World War II. Kaneru Humpy, the Indian star who broke the record for the youngest female to earn the Grandmaster title, tells us why she feels freer when playing open events. You'll meet the Ugandan chess star Fiona, Queen of Katwe Mutesi, who became an international symbol for resilience. At its best, chess can be an aspirational model for our culture. What would it be like if we focused more on what people think and the decisions they make, and less on how they look, how old they are, or how much money they have? At its worst, chess can magnify the problems that come with a chess culture so dominated by one gender and by one type of mindset, no matter how magnificent those minds are. In the past decade, I've seen far more chess events for women, girls, and gender minorities, including workshops, camps, and tournaments. I have supported and led many such spaces. As one student from my U.S. Chess Girls Club said, "It is inspiring to know that there are other girls out there who love chess and that I'm not just crazy." I want to see new passionate chess players all over the world pick up the pieces and checkmate without apology. And I want for them to be accepted with open arms by a chess world with no place for harassment or elitism. Because while this book may be filled with chess queens, there is always room for more. Chapter 1, Playing Like a Girl. I am a woman who plays a man's game, so I balance feminine emotions with masculine logic to become the strongest player possible. Zhu Shen, 9th Women's World Champion. I was angry, overwrought, and couldn't control my aggression and desire to win at all costs. It was the first time I had felt such intense killer instincts, and when I went to the bathroom to splash water on my face, I looked in the mirror and wondered, is this what it means to play like a man? It was Christmas in Las Vegas, and I was 22 years old. Accompanied by my father, Michael, a now inactive chess master, I was there playing in a chess tournament. As we walked through the hotel, the Paris Las Vegas, with its wide carpeted boulevard, sky-painted ceilings, and beret-wearing waiters with fake French accents, my cheerful father ironically declared in a booming voice, "This is so authentic." I was less enthusiastic. I didn't like gambling or even poker back then, and I was baffled by the slot machine junkies and sad-eyed big money losers. Soon after the original publication of this book, I learned to play poker for my brother. I learned that poker was also a mind sport and could be approached like chess, as a game to study and master, and as a vehicle to travel the world, empower women, and understand myself and other people better. The hectic tournament schedule was set at 2 games a day. Each game would likely last between 3 to 6 hours. I was already exhausted and running on caffeine, sandwiches bolted in transit, and the adrenaline rush that accompanies an encounter as intense as a chess game. The games were played far from Paris, in a sterile ballroom in Bally's Casino and Resort. I'd had a lukewarm tournament so far, winning 2 games against masters I was favored to beat, and losing 2 to grandmasters. My last round opponent was an affable, completely inoffensive master. I wasn't playing for any prize, so the source of my aggression was not lust for cash. Maybe it was a sharp attacking position that aroused my killer instinct. And anyway, I was angry and playing like a man or playing violently, which for me were the same. I was also playing badly. Too many aggressive but ineffective moves. I sacrificed a queen in a position where I saw that my opponent's best response, rejecting my queen sacrifice and fortifying his own position, would lead to a winning game for him. With just 1 minute on my clock, I was going to lose. My opponent offered me a draw. Riled up with all that masculine fire, I had the nerve to decline. With the next move, I came to my senses and renewed the draw offer. Luckily, my opponent, who by now had a clear advantage on the board, shook my hand in agreement. Did his lack of ruthless courage mean that he was playing like a girl? From open-air chess parks to professional tournament halls, playing like a girl has negative connotations, while playing like a man is a standard to be admired and emulated. It's no surprise that playing like a boy or playing like a woman are rarer phrases. Men and girls are on opposite ends of a continuum of strength and power. Boys and women in between are less apt categories for generalizing skill level. The stereotype that female players are naturally weaker chess players is widespread, stretching from the world's top players to total beginners. But I wondered if this concept was a foregone conclusion. We explain why women are weaker than men at chess without interrogating whether the opposite could also be true. So I started asking female chess players if there were any feminine qualities that contributed to their chess skill. Former European women's champion Almira Skripchenko responded after a pause. "I don't know. No one has ever asked me that before," admitting that to her, the male standard is the highest standard. Many women named advantages in being a chess world minority. "I receive more invitations and recognition as a woman," or "some men play badly against women." Biology is used often to explain the supposed inferiority of women in chess, but the women I asked only named advantages peripherally related to being female. At the moment of writing, the rate of female chess participation, especially at the adult level, is astonishingly low. In the United States, around 5% of competitive adult rated players are women. When you include youth players, the statistics are somewhat more promising. From 2010 to 2020, the percentage of female participation in U.S. chess hovered between 11 and 15%, a massive increase from 2000, when it was just 8%. In the worldwide ranking system of FIDE, the situation is similar. There, about 10% of active players are female. Countries with high rates of female participation, ranging from 25 to 40%, include Vietnam, Georgia, China, Mongolia, and Ecuador. Russia, Indonesia, and Kenya also rank well above average, between 17 and 25%. Some of the lowest figures come from Denmark, Ireland, Norway, the Netherlands, and Sweden, with 5% or lower. Interpreting data in such a male-dominated group is complex, but a good place to start is with ELO ratings, named after Professor Arpad Uilo. In the 1960s, ELO developed the rating system now used by FIDE to estimate the relative strength of chess players based on previous results. After each tournament, ratings are revised to reflect the player's performance. A master player's rating ranges from 2200 to 2400, and an international master or a grandmaster is usually rated between 2400 up to 2882, the highest rating of all time, earned by Magnus Carlsen in 2014. It is typical to confuse a low rate of participation with poor performance. The percentage of top female players has to be compared to the percentage of active female chess players and to the number of games that women and girls play. The top female player of all time, Judit Polgár, reached a career high of number 8 in the world in 2005. In the United States, there are currently 3 women in the top 100 players in the country. Not an encouraging stat on its own, but pretty close to the percentage of female players. There is no clear evidence that women play worse than men. There are, however, clearly fewer women who play, and those who play, play fewer games on average. Explanations abound as to why women are rarely drawn to competitive chess, including Freudian theories, studies on the importance of testosterone, and evolutionary theories. Garry Kasparov, who held the world championship title from 1985 till 2000, now supports women and girls in chess. But in his early career, he dismissed female chess talent, explaining that the ability to concentrate is the most important quality in a chess player. He argued that women are more easily distracted. A woman's train of thought can be broken more easily by extraneous events, such as a baby crying upstairs. Kasparov said that women are more sensitive to external stimuli, so that even a childless woman has maternal impulses that make it harder for her to focus. To test Gary's theory, I propose a tournament with 100 female and 100 male participants to be held under a baby nursery. It would then be possible to see how men and women react and adapt their play to the distracting cries of babies. The male variability hypothesis is another theory that's frequently tossed out. This is based on the idea that men have more variable IQs on both the high and low end. It's often nicknamed as the more idiots, more geniuses theory. That one irritates me most of all. Partly because, from the data I've seen, male IQs might have more variability. But when I see this theory mentioned, it's ableist, exaggerated, and used in bad faith to make strange logical leaps, often by non-scientists, trolling successful women. Presented in inappropriate contexts, this discourages females. I should know. I first heard about these ideas as a preteen at a chess camp, where a psychologist was invited to talk about gender in chess. With no understanding of statistics at that age, all I remember is seeing charts showing why my own potential was limited, the last thing I needed to hear at such an impressionable age. Even if the theory were valid, it's a leap to use this to explain why women play less chess than men. The link between genius IQ scores and chess skill is not clear, and the value of IQ itself is under constant scrutiny. Author and science journalist Angela Saini told me she wasn't sure what men were trying to achieve by citing such studies. And as she pointed out in her book, Inferior, the scientific picture emerging now is that there may be very small biological differences between men and women, but that these can be so easily reinforced by society that they appear much bigger as a child grows. American Grandmaster Ruben Fine, a world championship contender, professor, and author of many books on psychology, links the desire to play chess with latent unspeakable desires. In his 1956 treatise, Psychoanalytic Observations on Chess and Chess Masters, Fine writes, "The unconscious motive actuating the players is not the mere love of pugnacity, but the grimmer one of father murder." Women are less inclined to pick up the game, argues Fine, since they lack a subconscious urge to kill their father. Fine believes that the king attracts boys to the game because the piece is important. If it's trapped, the game is over, yet impotent. It can only move one square at a time. He argues that adolescent males are in a similar state because they are unable to express their budding social and sexual powers. In his view, the rules of chess mirror for boys the rules of sex. Don't touch your piece until you're ready to move, in codes to don't masturbate. That outrageous Oedipal model is just one of many possible ways to decode the symbolism of chess. I prefer to think of chess in the spirit of Carl Jung as a system of opposites, from the black and white colors of the pieces and squares to knowing when it is time to attack and when to defend. A good chess player also strives to balance overconfidence and fear, practice and rest, and in the game itself, tactical and strategic thinking. Tactics are short operations that force checkmate, or a quick win of material, and require proficiency in calculating. When a good player calculates, she considers her possible moves, taking into account her opponent's possible replies and how she would play against each, and so on, until she is reasonably satisfied with her choice. Though many non-players and amateurs are fascinated by how many moves ahead a chess master can see, it can sometimes be easy to see 12 moves ahead if there are a few pieces in the board, but extremely difficult to see 3 moves ahead if the opponent has a variety of responses, leading to a dense web of variations. Strategic thinking requires long-term planning and maneuvering. When there are no tactics to watch out for or employ, masters play moves based on their intuition and experience, waiting for the time when the position reveals more concrete answers. Even the very best players have difficulty with attention. As Russian-American Grandmaster Gregory Kaidanov said to me, "I can play well tactically, I can play well strategically, but I have difficulty switching quickly between one mode of thinking to the other." During a tournament game, balancing intense concentration with relaxation is crucial to save energy for critical moments. Many players get up between moves to pace, eat an energy bar, or glance at friends' games. It's easy to go too far with this practice, slip into daydreams, and totally lose concentration and the game. Some men claim that thinking about sex diverts their focus. A 22-year-old male amateur player told me jokingly, "I would be a grandmaster if only I could stop thinking about sex during the game for more than 15 minutes. I think it would be easier if I were a woman." According to the 4-time U.S. champion Alexander Shabalov, professionals have not overcome that obstacle. He said that most men, regardless of their strength, are thinking about sex for most of the game. With characteristic humor, the Latvian-born grandmaster told me, "In most games, I'm thinking about girls for about 50 to 75% of the game. Another 15% goes to time management, and with what's left over, I'm calculating." When I mention that 25 percentage points is a big range, Alex agrees. You can tell if it's closer to 50 or 75% by the quality of the game. 50% is great chess. 75% means I play okay. But where it's really dangerous was when it slips up to 90%. Learning the rules of chess takes a few hours, but gaining competence in its intricacies and developing a personal style takes years of work. Playing a highly focused board game for 4 to 6 hours is difficult, and neither men nor women nor non-binary players are born with the concentration and motivation to excel at it. For that reason, I find the emphasis on women's biological inferiority absurd. When it comes to chess, we are all born inept. The desire to find gender-based stylistic differences is based on a belief that if women and men are different, they ought to play chess differently as well. Indeed, women and men do tend to have different chess careers and get started in the game for different reasons. In my usage, the category of women's chess does not refer to some intrinsically female way of playing the game, but rather to being a minority in the chess world, which can affect the way women or gender minorities play. The development of my own style was affected by being one of the few girls in chess. My brother Greg and father Michael were both masters by the time I became serious about chess in high school. My father has a sedate style. He's an excellent calculator, but his tendency to choose solid positional setups such as the English opening, starting the game with a c-pawn, commonly thought as the safest first move option, surprises some people in the chess world. English Grandmaster Tony Miles, after taking in my dad's Iron Man physique, loud voice, and commanding presence, and after watching several of his games, said, "I thought you would play more like a thug." My brother has a balanced style, which favors tactics but is also flexible. He does employ solid systems against opponents when he thinks they will be uncomfortable with long strategic battles. Impressed by Greg's psychological awareness, one master told me, "Greg has the most pragmatic style I've ever seen." As a teenager, I played the most dynamic openings in the family and tended to win by executing ruthless attacks. I improved rapidly between the ages of 14 and 16. Just before I turned 16 in 1996, I entered the Insanity Tournament, an all-night chess marathon that began at 9 at night and ended at 9 the next morning. I won the tournament and also gained enough rating points to join my brother and father as national masters. I was euphoric. My father, who took the train with me to the tournament and stayed to watch my games, joked gleefully on the ride home, "No one could ever say you play like a girl." At the time, I considered it a compliment. I didn't see any reason for my violent style except that I liked attacking chess. However, I was aware of the stereotype that women were more patient and passive, while men were supposedly braver, and I wanted to be a hero too. In retrospect, I see my chess style was loaded with meaning. To be aggressive was to renounce any stereotype of my play based on gender. I was also emulating the attacking style of the top woman player in the world, Hungarian Jutta Polgár. For a while, I played recklessly, and at first I lost many games because of my one-dimensional style. Many opponents altered their strategies when playing against me, choosing quiet systems, such as the English opening, in order to derail the tactical melees at which I excelled. This resulted in my progress pursuing a zigzag course. I dip below master and back up again and then under again. I realized that I needed to learn other aspects of the game. So I began to study strategy manuals and endgame theory to improve my standard of play. I needed to curb my desire to subvert stereotypes by playing violently. By the time I was 19, I started to mingle in the higher ranks of international chess, playing in world championships and the biennial chess Olympiads. I realized that to play like a girl did not have the same meaning at the top as it did in Parkinson's Classic tournaments. It turned out that to play like a girl meant to play too aggressively. This was most vividly demonstrated to me when a Russian coach looked at some of my boldest games and said, "I see women's chess hasn't changed. Women have no patience. They always want to attack immediately." Even female players sometimes join the chorus. The first German female to earn the Grandmaster title, Elizabeth Pates, once told me, "Women are mostly of the more aggressive category. They don't want to sit for 6 hours, so they attack and try to get the game over with. Probably this is because men in the Stone Age had the more focused goal of hunting, while women had a variety of tasks." Grandmaster Susan Polgár also believes that women have difficulties in strategic thinking, although her reasoning is based on more recent history. "Women are rarely given the freedom to think abstractly. Men are often afforded the luxury of having their basic tasks, like laundry and cooking, taken care of. Women are usually compelled to focus on the details of life," Susan concludes. "This is the root of why women are equal to men in tactics, but still lag behind men in strategy." Pates and Polgár attempt to explain aggressive female play by referencing female characteristics, naturally and culturally. "I think we need to consider the conditions of the contemporary chess world. A feature of the present standard of women's chess is excessive aggression, a playing trait that may just be more common for masters rated 2300 to 2500, the range in which professional women fall. Grandmasters tend to have more balanced style." To determine whether women are more aggressive than men, one would have to compare the games of the top female players with the games of randomly selected male players rated 2300 to 2500. In determining a feminine style, the conclusions are rarely based on statistical analyses of the games. Playing like a girl, whether it is supposed to refer to passive or aggressive play, is usually intended as an insult. This devaluing of the feminine in chess dates back to the 1300s and the birth of modern chess rules. The queen is the most powerful piece on the chessboard, shuttling across ranks and files, checkmating lone kings, and grabbing loose pieces on an open board. This was not always so. In the Persian versions of the game, there was no queen. The piece that stood by the king was the first, or the advisor. Replacing this male counselor with the queen, the romantic partner of the king, occurred after Persian, Byzantine, and Arabian traders transported the game to Europe circa 1000 AD. Chess historian H.J. R. Murray thinks that this change came about because the general symmetry of the arrangement of the pieces, which pointed to the pairing of the two central pieces. The queen began as one of the weakest pieces on the board, and her presence was not revered. In 1345, when the queen could only inch along the diagonals, a medieval writer described her force. Her move is a slant only, because women are so greedy that they will take nothing except by rapine and injustice. Diagonal lines were then seen as sinister and sneaky, in contrast to the honesty of straight lines. The connotation lingers in English phrases such as crooks or straight up. In Go, a game which originated in China, the pieces do not connect in the diagonals. In chess, blundering on diagonals is more common than on the straight lines of the ranks or files, as I've often discovered when playing against the very sinister opening called the London. This popular and very solid opening involves an early development of the bishop to f4, which is often tucked into that diagonal for a long time, so long that it's easy to forget about it. The old chess was slower, with each game taking far more moves. It was hard to deliver checkmate without the mighty queen of today. Games were rarely recorded, and to quicken the pace, players often began the games with tabias, mid-game starting positions. Around 1500, the rules of chess underwent a sudden metamorphosis, and the queen was given much greater powers. The bishop acquired greater mobility at this time as well. These changes made the play of chess quicker and set up a balance between strategy and tactics, or intuition and calculation, which makes the game tantalizing to this day. The alterations occurred during the time of Columbus's bloody voyages and Queen Isabella's reign of Spain. No single individual is given credit for the changes. Probably they were initiated as a result of a collective experimentation brought on by dissatisfaction with the old game. Chess literature spread the new rules, which were rapidly standardized with the contemporaneous advent of the printing press. Chess, with its radical new rules, was at first called the Mad Woman's Chess Game. Emery Tate, one of America's most entertaining and talented senior masters, humorously displayed his ambivalence toward powerful women as embodied by the queen. Emery had a spectacular style, and at open tournaments, he was known for his impromptu performances, his muscled body wreathing as he shouted out the moves of his games. Emery reeled off his accomplishments in rapid-fire diction punctuated with profanities. In one of these so-called postmortems, I was among several dozen onlookers when Emery explained, "And now I made a triple force postal move, bitch to G5. The first part of this is nonsensical rhetorical flourish. There is no such thing as a triple force postal move. As for calling the queen a bitch, she is central to the inspired checkmating attacks that Emery loved. The reception of the potent 16th century queen also showed a negative association with female aggression. The new queen was not described in a positive way as a super queen or power queen, but rather pathologized as the mad, crazy queen. In a 2017 art piece, not particularly beautiful, that I created with my husband, Daniel Marome, we showcased misogynistic insults toward female chess players on an oversized chessboard. The piece referenced insults to the Mad Women Chess Queen's game from the 16th century, tracing a 500-year lineage of anger and resentment toward female power in chess. "Women are too docile," claimed English grandmaster Nigel Short, "to enjoy the highest levels of chess competition. They just don't have the killer instinct," he said. "Men and women's brains are hardwired differently." Reuben Fine was straightforward in defining chess as quite obviously a play substitute for war. But is chess really so like war? In chess, both players begin with armies of precisely the same strength and use only their intellects to express their aggression. In this way, chess is antithetical to war. Women's world champion Susan Polgar said that when she was 4 years old, she pictured chess as a fairy tale, because her father told her dramatic stories involving the king, the queen, castles, and romance. If chess is a metaphor for war, it is not war as hell, but war where fairness, females, and rules matter above all. The power of the queen foreshadows the strength of the women champions in this book, but it also hints at something more sinister. Author and historian Marilyn Yalom writes that the queen is an ultimate female status, but one which is played out in life as in chess on a predominantly male playing field. Empowered women are often called bitches or mocked for their lack of femininity. Nearly every up-and-coming female in the history of women's chess has had her femininity minimized, complimented not for being a strong woman, but for playing like a man. Many great women players have been called Amazon, which means literally without one breast. In chess variants, an Amazon refers to an even more powerful queen that also possesses the movements of the knight. As much hate as the Mad Queen got when she gained her new powers, she made a better game. The Mad Woman's chess became chess, as we know it now. In February of 2003, I received a call from Susan Polgar, the eldest of the legendary Polgar trio from Hungary. She wanted to get together. I was excited because Susan was one of my childhood heroines. Susan, along with her sisters Sophia and Judith, was a child prodigy, trained from infancy in chess tactics and strategy, as most kids are taught the alphabet. Susan was one of a handful of women to hold the overall grandmaster title and is a former world women's champion. Born in Budapest, Susan moved to New York in 1995, where she moved to be with her husband. She started a family and took a hiatus from competitive play. Susan and I met in a bookstore in Manhattan, where I found her flipping through a cookbook. She greeted me warmly, but moved quickly on to business, telling me that she was distraught by the lowly status of chess in the United States. In Europe, chess is a respected sport. It occurred to Susan that the top women players in the United States, with some training, would be strong enough to compete with the best women's Olympic team in the world. She hoped that this would promote chess in the United States. Susan would come out of retirement in order to train the team and play board one, where the strongest players from each team face off, during the next Olympic Games, set for Mallorca, Spain in 2004. 4 months after our meeting, along with three other young women, I was invited for a one-week training session to be held at the Susan Polgar Chess Authority, a one-level community chess center and chess bookshop that Susan founded. The club is in Rego Park, deep in Queens, where English is often a third language. It was to be the first of 8 official training meetings for what team publicist Paul Truong termed the dream team. Anna Zatonsky was the only non-New Yorker on the squad, so she stayed with me in my Brooklyn apartment. Anna, an international master who was 25 years old at the time, arrived at my place and shyly presented me with a box of chocolates from the Ukraine, where she had been born and raised. Anna has a wild jawbone, silky dark hair, and legs so long she seemed overwhelmed by her own stature. Anna was not yet fluent in English, so the first few hours between us were awkward until we sat down at the chessboard set up in my living room. Anna quickly opened up and showed me one of her best games, giggling with childlike glee as she replayed the moves. And now I sacrificed another piece. The next morning, Anna and I took the long subway ride to Rego Park for our first session. We were excited and nervous about training with the famous Susan Polgar. Anna and I were early, and we chatted awkwardly with Susan about her club and our upcoming tournaments as the other members arrived. Irina Crutch entered the club next, brown hair back in a ponytail, wearing a jean jacket, eating an apple. Irina became an international master at 16 and was the youngest player to win a U.S. championship as a 14-year-old. At the time of this session, Irina was enrolled as a full-time student at NYU. But her devotion to chess is constant. For me, every game of chess is a character test. Such intense situations arise so rarely in real life. Irina approaches life as she does chess with a contagious intensity. Though chess is her first and deepest love, Irina cultivates what she calls mini passions, such as ones for the French language and tennis. Rusadan Golatiani, an energetic and rail-thin woman in her 20s, completed the squad. Rusadan is from the ex-Soviet Republic of Georgia, where the first great women's chess tradition originated. In boring moments of endgame lectures, I sometimes stared at Rusa's snazzy, high-top sneakers and imagined her jumping over tall buildings. Rusadan's buoyant presence belies a serious character. In 2000, Rusadan fled a grim economic situation in post-communist Georgia. Upon her arrival in the United States, she spent most of her time coaching chess to support herself. This also enabled her to send money back to friends and family in Georgia. Consequently, her chess activity abated, and she was the lowest-rated person on the team. However, by common consensus, she may be the most talented player, often reeling off variations, long strings of projected moves, and finding surprising ideas and analysis. The training program was exhausting. Each day began at 10 in the morning and ran until 7 at night. Grandmaster guests came, taught, and left. Conversations and lectures were conducted in a swirl of English, Russian, and chess. We analyzed complex endgames, investigated the weaknesses in our play by showing our worst games, and played training games against each other. This grueling work was rewarding for me as a chess player, but one afternoon, my peaceful progress was punctured by a sexist discussion. Michael Khodorkovsky, a Russian trainer who works closely with Garry Kasparov, is a sturdy, baldy man with piercing blue eyes, kind mannerisms, and confident diction. Michael began his session with us saying, "I know that feminism is popular in the United States, but in Russia, we understood that women and men play differently." Michael advised us, "With this in mind, you should never be ashamed to tell your trainers most intimate details, or when you may not be able to play 100%. Paul Truong, a fuzzy-haired ball of energy with a tittering laugh, clarified Michael's statement for the team. "Does everyone know what Michael is talking about? Menstruation!" I thought I had entered a twilight zone, an impression that was furthered when Susan Polgar, one of my childhood heroines, joined forces with Michael. Now, menstruation may not require that someone take a day off, but it might affect, for instance, the choice of opening. Michael mentioned a computer program that a Soviet friend of his had developed, which would determine how, at any given day, the menstrual cycle would affect play. I was too shocked to say much, though later that afternoon, I could not resist joking, after suggesting a poor move in analysis, that it's that time of month can't think straight. The laughter that ensued made me hopeful that no one took the issue too seriously. Periods were happily left undiscussed until a few days later when the whole team took a break from our formal training to visit the IBM headquarters in New Jersey. IBM, a sponsor of our team, generously donated computers to us and allowed us to play against Deep Blue. The computer developed by IBM in 1997 that made history by defeating Garry Kasparov in a match. Susan Polgar gave a talk about her career and life story to a group of computer programmers, many of whom were amateur chess players and many who had feminist views. Then Susan grappled with the question, why is only one woman, my sister Judith, among the top 100 chess players in the world? Susan argued that although many of the causes were social, the monthly problem gets in the way of the full development of many women chess players, since women may be menstruating during a crucial game. Other strong women players, such as Irina Krush, prefer not to play while menstruating. Even if I could not relate, never having had problems myself playing while bleeding, how could I contest the testimonies of my peers? Susan's argument was not that all women suffer during menstruation. Indeed, she was quick to point out that though many women cite no special problems playing during these times, others are barely able to get out of bed. Susan often felt faint when playing on her period and even fell off a chair once. As she told Psychology Today, in a game where every point is precious, even 1 minute of discomfort could jeopardize a woman's score. Though the article's author, Carlin Flora, counters, Mother Nature may have equipped female chess players with a compensatory measure, however. The extra estrogen surging through a woman's body during menstruation aids concentration. Susan's argument is dangerously circular. When a strong, powerful woman such as Susan is vocal in describing the deficiencies of the female body, she promotes such discourse as legitimate. Such statements can make female players more conscious of their periods, who would otherwise not even consider menstruation as an obstacle. In her doctoral dissertation from the California School of Professional Psychology in Los Angeles, psychologist and amateur chess player Linda Carol Gilbert details the sloppy methodology of previous writing on gender in chess. In her work, Chess Players, Gender Expectations and the Self-Fulfilling Prophecy, she argues that the way we talk about women in chess influences the reality of women in chess. A vicious cycle emerges when world-caliber chess celebrities voice their opinions on why women don't play as well as men and cite science, perpetuating a disastrous self-fulfilling cycle that results in females being unfairly labeled as inferior. Talking about menstruation as a problem perpetuates menstruation as a problem. The argument is also reminiscent of doubting women's capabilities in politics and business. How could we elect a female president? What if she had her period during a war? The cultural depiction of menstruation is still oppressive. Even the casual labeling of the natural female cycles as a problem is an example of how the female body is considered substandard. The way that pads and tampons are advertised, because you're the only one who has to know, associates bleeding with a shameful secret. When I was a teen, magazines had special sections in which girls wrote in to tell humiliating stories of bleeding excessively in front of hotties or in a pool. Instead of shaming girls for their natural bodily rhythms, we can instead celebrate the power it represents and the gorgeousness of red, my favorite color. Susan is a pioneer in chess, the first woman ever to compete at the highest level as a grandmaster alongside male professionals. Her life had shown that with the same work ethic, women could be the players that top men could. But now she was doubting that women had equal potential. Such a contradiction between a woman's chess player's words and accomplishments is not atypical, partly because, as five-time British women's champion Harriet Hunt noticed, most of the best female chess players just play without knowing too much about feminist theory. Most feminists in chess don't have enough time to work on the game. I was happy to train with the top female players and coaches in America, but I was offended by the discussion of menstruation. In 2020, I started a cross-cultural program with U.S. chess women in cooperation with the Lighthouse Chess Club in Mombasa, Kenya, and Business Meets Chess and Kids. We introduced girls in Kenya, later growing to other African countries, and USA, using online chess as a medium. After one of our sessions, a Kenyan member of the club sent me a message explaining that menstrual inequality prevented many girls from going to school or playing in chess tournaments. That student reminded me that menstruation can indeed be an impediment for some girls and all over the world because of the expense and unavailability of the products themselves. In the context of this chapter, I now think that topics like menstruation or pregnancy should not be taboo, but tackled with a positive approach rather than as an explanation for inferiority. For example, a coach could advocate to get all bathrooms at a tournament hall stocked with a variety of products and even provide equipment like increasingly popular period underwear. Super absorbent underwear, adding a secondary layer of protection for menstruating people who may have heavy flows but can't take hourly bathroom breaks. That week symbolized my ambivalence toward the larger chess world, which is a driving force behind this book. I love the passion, diversity, and intelligence in the chess world, but I'm often frustrated by the sexist views I encounter there. One IBM employee shared my feelings on the speech. I love the talk till she brought up periods. Why? Why did she have to go there? Focusing on supposed impediments such as menstruation distracts us from the fact that there are many women for whom chess is a profession and still others for whom it is an important and essential part of their lives. I reject the negative tone that wraps itself around women's place in chess. Instead, I will now turn my attention to the variety of strong and passionate women who have broken the glass chessboard. Chapter 2. War-Torn Pioneers, Vera Menchik and Sonia Graf. Vera Menchik was the first woman to play chess like a man, Grandmaster Salo Flor. Sonia Graf has written a book. We must be in the presence of something singular. Roberto Grau, Argentinian chess writer. Vera Menchik and Sonia Graf played in the first head-to-head match for the Women's World Championship chess title in the summer of 1937 in Semmering, a winter sports resort in Austria. The contrast in their chess styles predicted exciting games. Sonia attacked with ruthless abandon, while Vera excelled in positional play. Physically, they differed even more radically. Sonia was an expressive blonde with a confident stride, while Menchik had a sweet round face and was impassive and modest. A British reporter wrote, "Sonia smokes without end and during breaks eats candies. Between moves, she paces and talks with observers. Menchik is heavyset and sits all game with her hands in front without even moving a muscle in her face." Vera Menchik defeated Sonia Graf, ending up with 11.5 points out of a possible 15. Vera's overwhelming victory was not surprising. Just over 30 at the time of her victory over Sonia, Vera had already won 6 world titles. It was the last time the two would face off in a match. World War II altered the trajectory of both of their lives and the history of women's chess. In photographs, Vera Menchik is pictured smiling sweetly with nary a mean bone in her body. But her tournament records and game scores depict a different Vera. Beneath this gentle veneer was a trailblazer who raised the bar for women's chess. Vera Menchik was the first woman to compete seriously against top male professionals. Born in Moscow in 1906 to a Czech father and a British mother, Vera learned chess from her father when she was 9 years old. Early on, she played in a club tournament among boys and finished in 3rd place, which she later said gave birth to my sporting spirit. Despite this early show of chess talent, Vera's main passions were for literature and theater, not chess. Vera came from a comfortable family and shared a 6-room apartment with her father, mother, and sister Olga. Vera was 11 years old at the time of the 1917 Russian Revolution, after which Vera and her family were forced to share their ample space with neighbors. A friend of Vera's described what happened. People from below came up, bringing their goats and fowls with them. Below was a forbidden land to her sister and herself, and of course extra fascinating on that account. People lived in these basements in great poverty. They had earth floors, and the children were terribly dirty and ill cared for. Unhappy with these changes in lifestyle, the Menchik family decided to immigrate. The family settled in Hastings, a seaside city in England. Teenage Vera, shy by nature and struggling to become fluent in English, found her interest in chess flourishing as her loneliness deepened. Chess is a quiet game, she pointed out, a perfect activity for someone who does not speak the language. Vera began to play regularly, in spite of the critics who were concerned that the deep silence and smoke is not appropriate for a young woman. Hastings was a lucky place for Vera to settle. The Hastings Chess Club was one of the most well-established in England, founded in 1882. International tournaments were held there each year, attracting some of the best players on the continent and in England. Vera joined the club in 1923 and soon caught the attention of a Hungarian player, Géza Meraxi. Meraxi began to train her. It was a good match, and Vera improved rapidly, developing a patient style similar to Meraxi's. Unlike Vera, most women players were not systematically trained at the time. Vera Menchik soon became dominant among women. By 1925, she was unquestionably the strongest female player in England, having defeated the second best, Edith Price, in 2 matches. In 1927, she got a chance to test herself on the world stage. The first ever Women's World Championship was to be held in London. 16 women from 7 countries would participate in the round robin, Everybody Plays Everybody, which was scheduled in conjunction with the first men's world team competition. Vera swept through the tournament, seeding only 1 draw. She won the next 6 Women's World Championships, held in Hamburg, Prague, Folkestone, Warsaw, Stockholm, and Buenos Aires. Out of the 69 games she played in those championships, she won 64, drew 4, and lost only 1. Vera was miles ahead of the competition in women's chess, but thirsty for more distinctions. Victories over women don't satisfy me anymore. I want to drink men's blood. Vera Menchik's first chance to prove herself against men came in 1929 in a tournament in Ramsgate, an English seaside resort. Menchik represented Czechoslovakia on a team composed entirely of foreigners, giving her an opportunity to play against the best male players in England. The Englishmen were trounced, most notably by Vera, who shared the 2nd highest score with Pole Akiba Rubinstein. The winner by 0.5 was the Cuban world champion Jose Capablanca. Vera's own coach, one of the strongest masters in the world, Géza Meraxi, also played with the foreign team under the flag of Hungary. Training Vera helped her more than Coach Géza could have counted on. His young pupil finished ahead of him. Her result was described as outstanding, and her ability to come out unscathed against such opposition astounded the chess world, particularly in view of Vera's youth.
After Ramsgate, Farah was welcomed into the elite chess arena and given opportunities to compete against the top men in the world in tournaments all over Europe. During the summer of 1929, she was invited to a particularly strong round-robin event in Carlsbad, a small town in Czechoslovakia. An Austrian participant, Albert Becker, was so shocked by her inclusion that he devised a humiliating plan. Anyone who lost to her would receive a lifetime membership in the Vera Menchik Club. In comic retribution, he was the first to lose to Menchik and thus became a charter member of the club. Aside from that satisfying incident, Menchik's overall performance in the tournament was not good. She came in last, scoring just 3 points out of a possible 15. Also in 1929, Menchik traveled to Paris for her first international tournament. She didn't fare well there either, scoring only 3 points out of 12. One notable opponent was Marcel Duchamp, the celebrated conceptual artist and painter, who for some time gave up art to pursue his passion for chess. Born in France, Marcel spent most of his life in New York City, as well as a year in Buenos Aires, when his interest in chess was most intense. Marcel's position in the chess world was similar to Vera's. Both were superstars when they played world-class events, Duchamp because of his fame as an artist, and Vera because of her gender, even though they were weaker than most of their opponents. The most famous game played between Duchamp and a woman remains the one chronicled in a much-celebrated photograph. In it, he is playing against a completely naked Eve Babbitt, an American writer. Babbitt had just started taking birth control pills, which made her breasts swell to the size of bowling balls. Not sure at first if they were going to just pose or also play. Babbitt later wrote, "Marcel, whose obsession with chess made him give up not only art but girls, was waiting for me to make the first move." She was a novice in chess, and Duchamp won the first game in 4 moves. This piece has been recreated by many artists over the years, but always with a naked woman versus a clothed man. In 2009, I made a new version. I faced a naked man. The chess set we used for this game was also composed of carved nudes, and I used the queen to execute a frontal checkmate. When Vera and Marcel played, both clothed, Marcel found a tactic netting 2 pawns for nothing. With careful play, he should have easily won. But after a few mistakes by Duchamp, Menchik fought back to earn a draw. Menchik ended in 11th place in the tournament, with Duchamp right behind in 12th. In the next decade, Menchik played in tournaments with the world's top players, sometimes defeating the best in the world. The Vera Menchik Club grew, adding 2 particularly distinguished members to its ranks. Future world champion Max Uwe and future U.S. champion Sammy Reshevsky. However, the cold numbers of the scorecards revealed that Vera's percentages against the world elite were generally poor. In Moscow in 1935, she played in a tournament attended by luminaries such as world champions Jose Capablanca, Emmanuel Lasker, and Mikhail Batvinnik. Some Soviet organizers, who worried that her standard of play was too weak, had discouraged Menchik's participation. It was finally decided that Vera could play since she might provide a positive example for rising Soviet female players. Unfortunately, Vera was not to be a vampire this time. She finished last with just 3 draws, giving her a horrendous score of 1.5 out of 19. She wrote, "I felt helpless to be a weak woman with nothing which to oppose my adversaries." In a rare bright spot of the tournament, she held a draw in her game against a tournament runner-up, Salo Flor. Spectators gave her an ovation. Vera was active in British chess politics and journalism. She met Rufus Stevenson, editor of the British Chess Magazine, and later secretary of the British Chess Federation. Rufus married Vera in 1937, and the couple moved to London. From then on, coverage on women's chess was expanded in the magazine. Annual updates on the state of women's chess, in addition to frequent coverage of women's events.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.